Hello and welcome to this special session at Davos 2017 on advancing the sustainable development agenda. There's a fantastic panel here that we will be discussing on how to make sure that we have the best examples and frameworks to action the promises made in 2015. The affluence creates its own excesses. Poverty creates its own deprivations. While we have good goals, these goals are nothing if we do not take them forward. And while we have objectives, the objectives themselves are not sufficient. In 2015-17 goals, 169 targets, as well as 304 indicators had been proposed. At a level, it looks like a huge task, but at the same time, if you break it down, it's a lot of small projects which can go ahead and ensure that the world can be a better place. Let me begin by introducing our panelists who are going to be sharing their experiences and telling us about what has been achieved so far and what must be done, what should be the speed and what can be the scale to ensure that SDGs meet the deadline of 2030. Let me begin by introducing Hindu Oumarou Ibrahim. She's the coordinator for the Association of Indigenous Women and Peoples of Chad. She's also closely working with the Tropical Forest Alliance. On my left, Helle Thorning-Schmidt. She's the Chief Executive Officer of Save the Children International and has been working very passionately on the subject. Let me also introduce two very strong business leaders who are joining us. Paul Polman, Chief Executive Unilever. He's also part of the International Business Council, has been a member of the United Nations high-level panel to ensure that business is collaborating on this agenda. And let me also introduce Mark Cutifani, who is the Chief Executive Anglo-American at United Kingdom, who's again also working very hard globally on several projects to advance the agenda. Let me begin by looking at how best should we understand SDGs. It means a lot of things to a lot of people. For each stakeholder group, there is a different interpretation, but ultimately the objective is the same. If I can begin with you, Helle, and ask you to share your experience so far, and how do you interpret SDGs for yourself and for the organization?
Well, first of all, let me thank you for being here. I'm very excited about it. I'm very excited that we're actually putting the SDGs front and center of the discussions that we have at the World Economic Forum. I've heard it more this time than I have in other years, and that is exciting. And the world is looking for direction. We are gathered here at this World Economic Forum to talk about responsiveness and responsibility. Responsiveness is the capacity to listen and to understand other people. Responsibility is actually trying to find out how can I, as a government leader or as a leader of a big corporate company, take the next steps towards responsible leadership. And everyone is talking about we need a new rules to regulate economic globalizations. And perhaps we do, but I would just suggest to all leaders that are gathered here today that we actually have rules. We have actually got a blueprint or a roadmap or a framework for how we should move on, and that is the 17 Sustainable Development Goals. So I'm excited if everyone at this World Economic Forum will get together and say, what can I do to actually walk the talk and make sure that my company, my government, whatever, are moving in the right direction for the Sustainable Development Goals. I am the CEO of Save the Children International, and what we have done in Save the Children, just to give you an example, I know it's easier for an NGO because that's what we're here for. What we have basically done is to translate the 17 Sustainable Development Goals into what that means for children. What does it mean for children? And we just come back to a strategy that is completely aligned with the Sustainable Development Goals, meaning that we are saying very openly, we want to reach the most deprived children. That's the promise of leaving no one behind. We want to reach the most deprived children, and we want to create a world by 2030, very soon, where no child has to die from a disease that we could have prevented before the age of 5, where all children get access to quality education, and where every child is protected and safe. That's our translation of the SDGs into our work. It's very simple. If you ask any of the 25,000 people that works for Save the Children, they will be able to repeat that.
I'll come to you on specific projects that you find have been successful and the challenges there for. Hindu, what about you? You're also in a place in the region which requires a lot of support, and you are pioneering work on that. Give us some sense of what do SDGs mean for you and the teams that you're working for.
Firstly, thank you so much. I'm really excited also to be here, and it's really a good topic to be discussed in Davos. For me, coming from Chad and coming actually from the community-based and indigenous peoples, SDGs is not meaning like growing economy or meaning a big town, how we can converge to have like a big presence on others. For us, the SDG is meaning a life and livelihood of the peoples, and giving equity, giving chance to everybody to get his survival. So it can be best for us through the environmental issues where people can get them life, get them livelihood, and get them development. And it means also the peace and securities, because we cannot manage to get the sustainable way of life or the development or a sustainable economy without having peace and environmental protections. So if I can give you the example from the region where I'm coming from, in Chad, like the famous one, it's around the Lake Chad. That's all the people saw can talking about it. But then this place is famous because there is a lot of impact there. But there is something special. There is a lot of life. More than 30 million people living around this place. And they are not living just to like say, I want to be a big business, or I want to be a president, or I want to be something. But they are living there. They say, I want to ensure the survival of my next generation. I want to get food for my kids today. And how can I ensure it tomorrow? So meaning of the sustainable development goal for us, it's meaning how those peoples can get a better life, how they can get a chance to do not move to one region to another one just to say, I want to have clean water. Then how they can get also like education, the basic one, health, because they do not have this one. And this equity can get people together. And we know that we cannot pass without being a partnership with all the different stakeholders, from the government, from the private sector, from the NGOs, but with these peoples and what these peoples need. They have to define what the sustainable development goal for them mean, to do not make the mistake of the sustainable, not development, the MDGs.
Correct.
Yeah.
Thank you. It's survival and livelihood, which are two so intrinsically linked, and I think that's something which we don't really appreciate when we are living outside the regions that you're talking about. Paul, you have, for the last few years, very aggressively championed the cause from MDGs to SDGs, as well as leading from the front amongst the global CEOs. How do you see the interpretation of SDGs today?
Well, I think Hindu put it very well. I think that for the first time we have a universal agenda, one of the big discussions, and we just came from President Xi's talk in the Congress Hall, is the world functioning or not? And I think increasingly people are realizing that there are shortcomings. And one of the reasons I've put a lot of energy behind the SDGs myself is I see it as a moral compass at a time that the global governance is difficult, to say the least, and we don't have the right institutions to deal with many things. The UN, and frankly all the 193 nations that have signed it, have risen to that challenge and signed this wonderful agreement in September 2015, and basically saying to the world, we are committed to irreversibly eradicate poverty in a more sustainable and equitable way. And unlike the MDGs, it's a universal agenda. It's a one for peace, prosperity, planet, people, and obviously a partnership, which I think is the most important thing. And what you see with these goals, which are 17 goals, they're all incredibly interrelated. We're all very happy there's a goal on gender equality, or a goal on climate change, or a goal on health or hygiene, the forest, the oceans, the land, partnership. But if you peel the onion, you see that it permeates everything. Climate change needs to be solved if you want to solve food security. Women are the ones that suffer most from climate change. Many people are are deprived of education because of climate change. We certainly would have issues with our forests or with our oceans because of that. So these goals are well thought through, but they need to be seen holistically. And it's a goal for everybody. We cannot achieve that alone. The cost for implementing these goals are about $3 to $4 trillion a year, which frankly is only 3 to 4% of the global economy. And the benefits by implementing them are enormous. We estimate between 12 and up to 30 trillion by 2030. So here we are in a global economy that isn't growing. We have a hard time creating jobs, making it inclusive. We're fighting with each other to what at times appears make it worse. And we have this agenda given to us on a silver platter. Now, the overseas development aid from all the countries in the world is more or less $160 billion. $3 trillion, $160 billion, it just doesn't work. So the private sector has to get involved, and we have to find ways, obviously, to get the private sector to finance the bulk of this program if we want to make it come alive. And then for that reason, we need to work together, have the right frameworks there with governments, the right NGOs to be sure that we represent the people for which are square in the middle of the SDGs, and then businesses themselves to really put their business model to the service of the SDGs. I have a very simple opinion that if businesses cannot convince you that they are actually contributing to making this a better world, why should we have these businesses around in the first place? That's so whilst shareholders need to be satisfied, they cannot be the objective of running your business. And what we have seen is that the average length of a company 50 years ago was about 67 years. Now it's only 17 years. And the reason I think is because they're running it for the wrong reasons. So the SDGs offer tremendous opportunities for the private sector to get involved in. If you have 800 million people going to bed hungry, these people need to be fed. If you have 1.8 million children below five dying every year of infectious diseases, these kids need to be taken care of. If we have millions, hundreds of millions excluded from education, offers an incredible opportunity. So if we can unlock that by making the value chain work in partnership, we can really, in the next 15 years, eradicate poverty and obviously also deal with the enormous issue of runaway climate change, which frankly is right. closely related to poverty. These things are two sides of the same coin, and I think people are starting to understand that now. So it's in business's interest, and it's a tremendous opportunity. Business that understands this and integrates, for example, climate change already has increasingly shown that it has a higher rate of return. They take risks away, they build reputation, can attract better people, and see business opportunities that are in sync with society also means then that sustainable business model. You cannot have a sustainable world in that sense if you don't create the sustainable business models in the first place.
No, that's great. I think also the equation that you shared of investing about $3 to $4 trillion and then getting a return of $12 trillion as you've calculated. I'll come back to me. It's a great equation. Yeah. Very simple, very powerful, but how will that work out? I think that's what I'd like to discuss more with you. Mark, this equation is powerful, and the sector that you are in, that is often at the front of a lot of anger against what's happening to the environment. How do you interpret SDGs, and how is that playing out in your business models?
Well, I think the first thing to do is acknowledge Paul's leadership across the global business in leading the conversation from a business perspective. And if I can give an extractive perspective that complements Paul's description, I think that might help people bring it down to the ground. In our case, we provide the goods that make life possible on Earth, literally. If you don't grow it or mine it, then we make everything here possible. However, the way we go about business is certainly in many cases unsustainable. And the thing that the SDGs provide for us is a framework, firstly, to have conversations inside our businesses. And we start in our conversations, for example, at Anglo American, is making the point that our true role in the business is to serve society. And in terms of the products we produce, how do those products make life better? But what we've now framed the conversation around is it's just as important to produce those products and produce them efficiently and deliver a return. It's about the how. if you're not producing those products and doing it in a way that's sustainable, working with communities, working with stakeholders so that they can support what we're doing, then our business by definition isn't supportable or isn't sustainable. And so partnerships, whether it's with local communities, whether it's with stakeholder groups, or whether those partnerships are with other businesses and governments, it's about the way we go about our business. Society has defined through the SDGs its expectations on what and how businesses should operate. We as a company embrace that guidance from society, and we've made it our number one priority in terms of defining how we go about doing our business for the long term. And we think if we can deliver on those objectives and work, and we've mapped the SDGs in terms of the ones that we can most materially impact in the short term, that for us becomes the way we go about our business, and we hope the way we define what sustainability looks like.
That's a great point, because I think the short-term and the long-term perspectives, sometimes they are at loggerheads with each other. They are contradicting each other. And as you have these conversations inside your organizations, the challenge is to convince people that you have to look beyond the short-term. Helle, if you can share some thoughts on where we are, what has worked so far? You have 2030 as a deadline. There's not a lot of time, but you also have to give time and space for projects to play out and see the impact. However, you need to also have some level of course correction. It's a very difficult balance. How do you see the changes that we must implement to make it better?
Well, I think the starting point here, and I really thank our two business leaders for being so clear about it. I noted what you were both saying. I mean, to say that the true role is to serve society and that there is a direction is very powerful. And I've actually come to this meeting, World Economic Forum, to hear more people saying that and to sign that the compact that that we have outlined for this meeting. It is very powerful to leave this mountain with a view, what can I do and how does this fit into my business model? And I'll challenge a little bit the difference that you're making between short-term and long-term. Because I think what we're realizing these days is that the long-term comes really fast and changes come really fast. So of course there's like the short-term, but the long-term, if you are a big company, a legacy company, an old company, you will need to think of the long-term. And it's good to think that that should serve society. You're asking where are we not doing so well and where are we doing well? And should we be careful to do something and then make mistakes? I think it's most important that we just do something. There will be mistakes in what we are doing together. Many corporate partnerships, some of them are fantastic, and I'd like to tell you about them. Some of them are not so good, and then you start again. But you can't just wait till you have the perfect model, and then that's when you start. And if I can just say, I think we should realize at this meeting, we're very far behind. We have promised the most deprived people of this world that by 2030, what is it, 13, 14 years from now, we will end extreme poverty. End extreme poverty. Not poverty, extreme poverty. And right now we have 350 million children living in extreme poverty. That's a lot of people. By 2030, people living in extreme poverty. That is not ending extreme poverty. That is going down a bit, but it's not ending extreme poverty. And if that is just one figure in the Sustainable Development Goals, just one figure that I'm pointing to here because I think this is extremely important, then we have to ask ourselves, are we on the right track or what more should we be doing here? And I think Paul has always said that poverty is not good for business. And I think that's a very global view that we have to remind ourselves. So it's not only, Paul, it's not only a moral obligation that you're talking about, it's also a business obligation that we're talking about here.
What has worked Helle, and that's what I think we need to discuss.
Yeah,
what has worked and what we need to do to make it better.
Yeah, but we have numerous projects, and we're just starting one with Unilever, which is a very expect a lot from. This is about vanilla production in Madagascar. Mm-hmm. And basically together, we are partnering up, and what we are doing is to try to make more sustainable vanilla production, better for the farmers, make sure that their children can go to school, have a better health system. We have Unilever being very certain that they will actually take the products of these farmers and helping us make this program possible. This is an amazing leap in the way that these farmers live right now. They have a long history of reproducing poverty and bad business practices. I think just in a few years, we will see an enormous difference in that particular project, and we have many of them across the world.
Thanks. Paul, you've said that we've achieved about 10% of the SDGs in terms of the goals. Is there an understanding of which of these 17 goals are ahead and which ones are middling and which ones are lagging?
Well, when we did the Millennial Development Goals, I think we do deserve to pat us on the back a little bit, because between 2000 and 2015, we set as a simple goal to halve the number of people living in poverty, and lo and behold, we have achieved that. And some people might say it's China or it's this or that. I've been in business enough to understand there's always a reason for something, but we have achieved that. And more people have access to water, more women are participating in the global economy, more people are in education, we all live longer. It's really a good time to be born. So I don't think we should start here from a crying session in that sense. What we now see, obviously, is that what we did in 2000, the issues were quite different from what we are seeing now in 2015. Frankly, the issue of climate change was not on the agenda because it wasn't an issue. People are now discovering that in 30 years' time, there's more plastic in the oceans than there is fish. So Houston, there's a problem, is cutting through to everybody now. So the climate change agenda with Paris has really bent the curve of 4 degrees to 2.7 degrees. We need to get it below 1.5 degrees. We have a very good framework where all the countries have committed. Now we need to see if we move it up. Very encouraging to see China 2 weeks ago adding another $320 billion in their conversion to green energy. And we need to now see that other parts of the world, and obviously you need to focus on the big countries to have impact, your country, United States, China, that they follow suit. But business is moving since Paris, because business doesn't like anything better than certainty of direction. So you might or might not like climate change. That's not an issue here. But as soon as the governments of this world said, we're going to decarbonize this global economy, what happened? The market for divestiture, or the funds of divesting of carbon, we thought we could get $500 million in Paris. We ended up getting $900 million. Since Paris, that a billion. Since Paris, that market is $5 trillion. We at best had 450 companies that had an internal price on carbon. It's a smart thing to do. We now have 2,000 companies with an internal price on carbon. The financial community asking for a price on carbon was difficult to find before Paris. Now we have $34 trillion. Dollars of money under management asking for a price on carbon. So once a direction is given, the financial market gets involved, things start to accelerate. And you see that also happening, hopefully, with the Sustainable Development Goals. Now, where is the challenge? 17 goals, 169 targets, a global economy that isn't quite working, an average tenure of a CEO that is 4.5 years, an increasing focus, as you rightfully say, on the short-termism in the financial markets, or may I say, also in the political arena. And obviously, the issues of food security or poverty or the future of mankind cannot be solved with quarterly programs. So for that reason, in Unilever, when I became CEO now nearly 9 years ago, we abolished quarterly reporting, we abolished guidance, we moved our compensation systems to the long term, because I felt if I don't give that space to our people in the company, it's unfair to mm-hmm. ask them to be part of this program. But you know, how can we say that we value investments in IT, we value investments in our factories, we value investment sometimes in training of our people that all have payouts of 5, 6, 7 years or more. Why shouldn't we have that same long-term view on the future of humanity? That to me is actually a bizarre question that you even have to answer sometimes.
That's true.
So,
but at the same time, Paul, the voices of the climate change deniers are rising again?
Well, I wouldn't say that. I wouldn't say that, and I wouldn't agree either. I think the we might listen to some of these voices because they're pretty loud. And there are certainly some people that...
And they're on some mountain, right?
Well, they might be in different places, but you need... First of all, reputation is not built on what people say. It's like what Helle rightfully said, it's good to hear so many people saying talking about the Sustainable Development Goals, but it's important to remind ourselves that reputation is built on what people do, not what people say. Stephen Covey in his book, Seven Habits, talks about you can't talk yourself out of issues you've behaved yourself into. In the last 200 years, this world is 5 billion years old. In the last 200 years, we've behaved ourselves in quite a significant pickle and have done more damage to this earth in 200 years as if intergenerational doesn't exist in the 5 billion years. So we have a job to do and we shouldn't underestimate that. And that's why the Sustainable Development Goals have, first of all, we need to create awareness. Because if there isn't awareness, you won't have that critical mass. The issue here is the direction is clear, but we need speed and we need scale so that it has impact. So we need awareness. And then we need companies to internalize that and put it into their strategies. That's a job to be done. We're trying to reach out to about 1,000 CEOs because we think we can get a critical mass to do that. Then we need the financial systems to work. The financial markets and a lot of regulations actually go counterproductive. And we need to figure out what are new financial tools. The market for green bonds has exploded since Paris, but it's clearly not enough. Different tools of blended financing and other things need to come in. And that's a lot of work. Then we need to work with governments to look at regulations. Because frankly, a lot of the regulations that we have now might not give you the effects that we're after. So can we de-risk the political process and move the regulations forward? And then the last most important thing, which actually I should have started with, I apologize, is we just have to create more leaders that are willing to take a little bit more courage to drive this agenda forward. Because at the end of the day, it's moral leadership. We frankly have the answers.
Leadership in business or in political?
It's leadership in society. Frankly, we have the answers to many of the things. We don't need more PhDs. We don't need to send more people to Mars. We know how to solve it. You know, we have the audacity to waste about $800 billion a year on food, as if it isn't anything. By the way, if that would be a country, it would be the third biggest country in climate emission after China and the United States.
But I think you use the word...
No, but it only takes $80 billion to feed the people that go to bed hungry. So any businessman who wastes $800 billion and for an investment of $80 billion, give me another option that is better. And this is an option, again, in humanity. So we know how to do this. We know how to protect the forests of this world. We know how to create jobs for people in Africa if we decide to invest in smallholder farmers. What do? We invest less. We don't put it in research. We don't share technologies. Mm-hmm. We don't sit together to work in partnership to overcome some of these shortages. And that gets to the essence of the SDGs, and to the essence actually of goal number 17, which is a partnership goal. It's not a partnership between you and me signing a contract. If people read it, what has been written down there by lots of people that have worked on it, it's a partnership for humanity, for the common good. And if people understand that level of morality that is behind that, which actually makes a lot of business sense as well, we can solve a lot of things. So that's why I come back to the shortage is moral leadership.
True, and I think the factor of behavior, both at the leadership level and at the individual level, I think that still has to play it out. Individual behaviors have not changed the way it should be. Hindu, can you share an example of a project that really excited you and was successful and that can perhaps inspire others?
Hearing firstly from Polman here talking about the global and how the global can change to impact the local. So for us, we are doing that at the local level and how the local can change and how they can use the resources that they have in the place without like counting on the international, as you said, technology who can never come or who can never show up to help them live. So what we do on the climate change also, because in our region who are really very dry, where there is a lot of lack of natural resources, water, and all the challenges on environment, so there is a lot of impact. So we are seeing people talking more about the environmental impact, seeing the land degradation, waters, and others. But there is something special, who is the social impact. The social life of the people has changed a lot. So the role of the man and the women changed a lot. And the conflict growing also a lot around this. It's not like the warm conflict who are the normal one. We know people fighting for the power, but people fighting for access into the natural resources. And if they do not have choice, it's becoming like migration. So after the migration, it's becoming conflict on integrism and others. So there is a lot of origin and a lot of impact going on there. So in my region, what we try to do in my organization, who is a little organization, I can never compare it to anyone here in this room. So what we do is how to help these social destabilizations to come together and to build a new world to get a sustainable life. So how to give the voice to the women. So we cannot give the voice to the women without passing through the traditional way of living to respect the tradition of the peoples. So we pass through the man, and we pass through the chief. So when we pass through them, we talked with them, we say the life changing now, and we are seeing how really it's impacting of our life. But if you give chance to the women to play certain kind of the roles, and that can help the society to get rebuilt together. So in this project, we help them to give the voice, and when women for the first time, they come, they can never see like you and me, Ellen, the months around here, but women sit there and men sit there. Then they talked. And they talk about the real life, not like how we achieve the 17th sustainable goal, but how we can get water, how we can get agriculture. So people talk about the real things that really they impacting them life, them daily life. Then they said, or women used to say, I'm working very far to get food. We have the example of working very far to get water and others. Yes, this is the normal around all the Africa. But how they can get the food? And when they work to get the food, working through just not GPS as you found the way, but through the trees. Yes. So when you get from these trees to that one, you can get this food. And how you can get your way back. So they develop a lot of knowledge around this one. And they don't have technology, and they develop knowledge in all this weather changing. And through the weather changing, if I can give the example, they are not saying it's going to snow in Davos, and like you need a strong shoes or a tree jacket and others. But they're doing that to see how it's going to rain next week, how it's going to rain next month or next year, and this can impact our life. And this is through the observation of the birds displacement. So when the birds displace from one point to another one, and it's certain kind of months that they know is giving them like an indication of weather changing. Then they also use like certain kind of trees and fruit to break them and see if the liquid inside is abundance or not. And that can give them the information about the rain, if it can ensure them livelihood for the next years, or they have to move from one place to another one. So this project, we developed it with UNESCO, and we are continuing on this. So people see how they can adapt to get them livelihood and the food. So we are not stopping there. We see, okay, this is fine using only indigenous traditional knowledge, but how we can use this one beyond to put with the technology, with the scientists, and with the government. So then we have the 3D modeling, 3D mapping. So through the 3D mapping, it's just like through the geographical information we have, we build a map of the regions, and we call the man come to figure out the big ripper. They say, oh, here is the mountain of the ski. No, sorry, we don't have ski, right. So we have sun. So this is the mountain where we have the sun, and this is the river, and this is the tree. So when man put all this information in the maps, so we call the women. Then the women come, they say, no, it's changed. Here where we get our medicine, here where we get our food. And when we call the man back, they said, yes, women are right. So when we figure out this map, it's helped the community to give them voice to develop them on development way. When the development agency come, they say they want to put them water in this point. Right. They say, no, we don't want to have the water in this point because we don't have a water problem there. We want to have the water here. Mm-hmm. So it's give them more voice to contribute in them on development and what they need. So, but from this national level, if it's not linked with the international level, it cannot help the other leaders to get to take the right decision. As you said, some people's denying on the climate change impact. And yeah, we are not talking about this part.
So right, thank you.
Then others accept. Yeah. So just to end in this one, like when we come in Paris as indigenous peoples, we said the world leader are there and the business are there, all the big peoples are there. So how we can give voice to the peoples? And to give voice to the peoples, we need to let them understand all the environmental issues, the development issues, it's linked with the right of the peoples. So we need to integrate the respect of the human right inside. Because if I didn't eat, it's my right who is violating. And if I didn't went to the school, all this is the rights linking with it. But if we don't have this one into the international agreement, at the practical level, we cannot implement it.
Right. So I agree with you. I think also the development of livelihood and giving options. So for example, I know about I Am the Code, which is teaching young girls to code so that they become self-sufficient and they're also part of the technology mainstream. Which brings me to you, Mark. Can technology help in leapfrogging some of these challenges? Are there examples that we can talk about?
Yes, I think it can. I think as business leaders, there are two things that we have to do much better than we have done in the past. And then the third element that goes that with innovation. First thing is to listen. Mm-hmm. In terms of the description that we've just been given about what's important in that local community and that broader community, as mining guys, and I use myself as an example, we used to think we'd go in there and say, well, this is what you need. The day that we took a step back and said, what is important in your life and how might we help you develop the future potential of your community and what role can we play, listening to that conversation, we start to understand how important every one of those elements are. And that's the starting point, and that's the new approach that we're introducing and promoting across our industry. Now, with that, we bring capital, we bring skills. We're looking to work out how we can help solve some of those problems using different innovations. For example, we've now identified a way that we think we can reduce water consumption by 50 to 80% in our mining operations. In the end, it doesn't matter if we're not getting the water to the right place as it fits for the community. So how do we work with communities and bring the technologies and skills that we have to help solve their solutions that they've defined, not what we think they are? That for us is the real partnership and a different way of operating. We had some sessions at the Vatican and we're talking about how do we change the way we engage with communities on the ground. One of the cardinals made the point, meaningful existence. Until you take the time as a business leader to understand what meaningful existence means to those local communities, you will never find the right equation or you'll never establish the right relationship with that community that allows you to operate as a true partner. Listening to that conversation and looking for the right innovative technologies and approaches that can support that view, not interrupt it or make it different, but to support what they're trying to achieve, that's where we'll make a difference. It could be water, it could be energy, it could be providing transportation infrastructure, commercial or otherwise, all sorts of solutions that can be found by us as business leaders bringing technologies that we don't think of in terms of our local communities. That's the difference. Listen to your local communities and understand how you can make a difference to their lives as they define what the future should look like.
And a different answer for every region, because you cannot have a common answer for everybody.
Exactly. Don't walk in thinking you know the answer. Keep your mouth closed. Use both ears
and
listen
your eyes
very carefully. Yes. And understand how you can help solve the problems that confront the people on a daily basis.
And sometimes the solutions lie with the people. They just need the catalyst to be able to make them work. Let me bring in some questions and thoughts from the audience. We have about 15 minutes left. And if you could please introduce yourself. I have a blind spot behind my head. So maybe I could come to you. And if you could keep it brief, then I'll ensure that we can get as many questions as possible.
Thanks a lot. Wolfgang Yaman, I'm with CARE International. have a question to Paul. You started very beautifully in describing the SDGs as a moral compass, which has the potential and maybe is kicking in the absence of a functioning global governance system. That's actually quite a nice but also steep ambition. My question to you is, do you think the SDGs themselves have a strong enough governance system, robust enough and inclusive enough around it to make it really successful?
Thanks. Good question.
So that's a good question, and first of all, also compliment caring on what you're doing and as part of driving the sustainable agenda. So the more we can get that critical mass, the better. I think the SDGs, the MDGs forgot partnership and forgot the private sector, and it was sort of an afterthought. Yesterday we were in Vienna at a conference with a few hundred people in the audience, and still about 25% of those people firmly believe that business should not be involved in the SDGs. So there is a challenge. We should not be naive about that. And I think more needs to be done also with the UN itself to embrace the private sector. We have the UN Global Compact that has 9,000 members. And obviously they're spreading the word. World Business Council for Sustainable Development, 35,000 members. The WEF here, obviously, with some of these initiatives. So that is starting to happen. But I think it would be better and easier if we had these partnerships more being championed by some governments in the world, often the ones who need it the most, and then obviously also working with civil society on that, as was mentioned before. Absolutely key. I would not touch any project anymore in Unilever without involving those three projects at scale, like the Symbrise project in that we do with Save the Children and us on vanilla in Madagascar. Where the UN also has not really a fully embrace this is on measuring. You treasure what you measure, and you have to think about it that you don't measure the wrong things. The original MDGs went a little bit quickly. They measured the number of people in education, but not the quality of education. So we're spending more time now on these measurements, but I wish we would have had a little bit of a broader reach out and get the right measurements, and we still need to do some work on that. And then it is a little bit difficult if you agree what needs to be done, and if you have the measures, it's only as good as you have your accountability and responsibility and transparency. And there is a little bit of a tension there still, because some countries feel that that transparency belongs to them, that accountability is not for the world to put on others. And I believe that the only way ultimately to build that trust again and repair society, which Edelman will be launching the trust barometer again at the WEF, and it has all gone down again, down for the press, down for the governments, down for the private sector, is the only way to restore that trust is if we work with transparency, because transparency is that basis for trust that you need to build prosperity, and then holding everybody accountable. So there are some things we still need to work on. And as you rightfully say, we're now 15% on the runway of the SDGs, we're in the plane. And we haven't heard the engines become louder yet. So I'm starting to worry a little bit, because normally you shouldn't lift off yet, but you certainly should hear the engines. And so we have to work on that part of it. And for that reason, we issued this report, and there are some commissioners here. We have some SDG advocates here. We issued this report on a better business, better world, if you want to, where we give some tools and scorecardings and transparency and some practical ideas, actually, how businesses can implement it in their own companies, but also in their value chain. And hopefully move the agenda forward. So I hope that gets to your question.
Great. One question here, please. And the lady at the back, maybe. Oh, okay, right at the back. So maybe I should collect the questions and then come back to everybody.
Sure. So I'm Gary Cohen with Becton Dickinson. So it was mentioned before, Paul, you mentioned before, the reduction in poverty, and that there's always a reason, and the economic development in China, you could add India and some other developing countries, were a major catalyst for that reduction in poverty. On the health-related MDGs, the most significant success was infectious disease, MDG 6, and the focus on HIV and AIDS, the Global Fund, and PEPFAR were major catalysts. On MDG 4, ending under age 5 mortality went from 9.6 million in 2000 to 5.9 million in 2015. Gavi and childhood vaccination, focus on pneumonia and diarrhea were major catalysts. Now, I know we're comparing a little bit apples and oranges, MDGs to SDGs, but what do you foresee as the catalyst? Because you mentioned before, you know, the engines haven't, just a moment ago, the engines haven't really revved up yet. These catalysts tend to be what fire up the engines. And can you foresee what may be the catalyst that, among other things, will help align private capital around these public sector needs? How will that alignment actually be
Thanks.
Accomplished?
So I'm requesting all the speakers to hold their thoughts and come to all the questions later. Yes, please. Mic there, please.
Thank you. My name is Corinna Hawkes. I'm with the Global Nutrition Report and the Center for Food Policy. So the panel spoke to the issue of cross-cuttingness and synergies between the goals, talking about the fact that children are relevant to all of the goals and that solving children's problems will help address all of those goals. The same was mentioned in reference to climate change. And in my work in food, we know the same for food, that we're only going to solve all of these problems if we solve food problems. So there's a lot of synergies. And in our work in the Global Nutrition Report, we know that if we address nutrition, we will address a lot of the other goals. And vice versa, in fact. What worries me is how are we going to have good governance and leadership to make sure that the synergies between the different goals are managed through to efficiently and coherently achieve those goals, as opposed to what we usually do and go back into our little segments and work towards our own goals that we care about. What are the incentives, what are those governance and leadership that we need to make sure that those of us who work, for example, as myself in food and nutrition, that I'm also helping other people achieve their goals and also encouraging other people to help me achieve what I care most about.
Thank you. At the back of mic over here, please, and then I'll come back to the panelists. Oh, so you're close to the mic, so just offer him.
Okay, thank you. My name is Alicia Bárcena. I come from Latin America and the Caribbean. I would like to say that in my region, I see that SDG is progressing very importantly. From the governmental perspective, almost all the governments are setting together an institutional arrangement. They are incorporating SDGs in the planning process and in the budgeting process. And I think what's missing now is the link with the private sector. So I really hope from this Davos meeting that we can make sure there's going to be a forum of the Latin American and Caribbean countries in April in Mexico, where 11 countries are going to report progress. And I think what we need now is a link with the industries to invite them to this forum, which is going to be on 26 to 28 April. And we really need the private sector.
Are you
there.
Saying the private sector in Latin America is not as enthusiastic?
Exactly. So we need them. And we have some of the companies here working in Latin America, Unilever, the mining sector. So we need to engage in this tripartite dialogue with the civil society as well.
That's a good call. Sharon.
Thank you very much. I'm Sharon, a young global leader from Nepal. I think you raise a very good point about that social investment side of the working the Unilever and Save the Children producing a vanilla ice cream. Is it vanilla?
Vanilla.
But just vanilla, all right.
Plain vanilla.
Without ice cream.
Yeah,
without ice cream,
vanilla.
All right. Sorry.
But vanilla.
Just want to quickly ask about this question for the panel. It's how much that micro and small businesses, especially social businesses, contribute towards the SDGs, and how are you going to measure those impact? That not the big company who makes a big commitment. There's lots of people does little thing in their own way without using a term SDGs.
Sure.
And as one of our colleagues said about the indigenous people's contribution, how you measure those. And is it a trend that we're looking at that SDGs is not only driven by the charities or UN bodies? Because when the charities and UN bodies comes, that development country sees as a dollar coming in rather than what the project need to be done. What is the bigger picture? So is it the social business or social conscience related approach, and as she mentioned, respect to the indigenous people is the way forward.
Right.
Because the first MDG failed because as a nature has given us 2 years and one mouth, nobody listened. We just applied. And is it a time to listen and to move forward?
That's a great point. So, you know, I'll come back to the speakers. We have exactly 5 minutes left. I'm going to begin with Paul and go around and end with you, Helle. If you could all respond in your own ways to each of the points which have been raised. If you have a question, I have the points here.
Yeah, I won't go through each of the points, otherwise we won't make it. But what makes us optimistic that this agenda can be done, I think we're getting at a point in humanity where the cost of not acting is higher than the cost of acting. So people that might not have the moral compass will certainly have the economic compass. and we're seeing that in climate change. In the U.S. now, coal is not economically viable because you have shale gas, or the more jobs are being created in green energy now than in the fossil fuel industry. So the economics give me hope. Millennials give me hope. There's definitely a big trend of millennials, which are now becoming the bigger voters group, and they need to get out to vote. We need to work on that. And they are also getting the biggest spending power, and they certainly are more purpose-driven than, unfortunately, our generation. And the last thing, I think the good side of the internet is that it creates transparency. You open every day the newspaper now, and there's someone caught with his pants down, to be honest. And there is no better way of transparency to drive behavior, in my opinion. In terms of the initiatives, because your question is you need a lot of initiatives because it's a big world. And initiatives are driven by Hindu's example, people like yourselves with the passion on the ground. So we shouldn't say, should we have less initiatives? No, what we should focus on is create a few initiatives on top of all the things that are happening on the ground that we can drive globally with scale. At the WEF, we started a few years ago the new vision for agriculture. Africa, 1 billion-plus people, going to 2 billion-plus people, has to import food now. What's going to happen? How many more people need to come on boats to Europe with all the other things? So we need to make Africa self-sufficient. New vision for agriculture. Get to sustainable agriculture. We got $10 billion of commitments from companies, and a lot of that is being invested already. Millions of jobs are being created. Thinking about it in terms of smallholder farming and job creation at scale, if you might want to, you need to do those things on top of the many initiatives on the ground. So it's a combination. And what is most powerful is actually sectorial, where you go into a joint value chain with the sector. On food waste, which is goal number 12 in the SDGs, is responsible consumption. And one of the 169 targets, I look like a loony, but I worked on it so much. Goal 12.3 is food waste. And so we've grouped all the big retailers and manufacturers together to see if we can make a significant dent in the food waste. And so you need these initiatives at scale on top of all the smaller ones that are happening. And then you need cross-sectorial initiatives. You take human rights. You know, which company can justify to have 150 million children still in your value chain? And there are 150 million children. And I'm talking between the ages of 5 and 12. How many can justify to have 20 million refugees in a value chain as slave labor?
We'll have to interrupt you here.
So cross-sectorial initiatives are equally important as this. On the final one on the countries, really quickly, there are 5 or 6 countries that have embraced the SDGs at ministerial level. And Colombia is the best example in Latin America. But clearly not enough yet. And we certainly are happy to channel a whole group of cross-sectorial people again with an agenda to this. We've done that with the new climate economy. We're doing that again with the Business Commission on Sustainable Development. And I think we've picked Ethiopia already, Colombia, Vietnam, Uganda, and 2 or 3 other countries. So if you have more, where there is commitment from the government, from the head of state, where there is a ministerial post on the SDGs, because all too often we go and we get involved and do a lot of things, and then there's no commitment because there's the next political cycle.
Thank you. Hindu?
Actually, just to say, synergy is very important, but how we can achieve this synergy, I think we can do that through the partnership, and a real partnership, not only in the purpose. Paul said that we write, we are partner, and that's it. No, really, we can take the example of the Tropical Forest Alliance 2020, where all the people come in the board. You have the government from the south, from the north. You have the private sector, the bigger one, the smaller one, and you have the civil society. You have the indigenous peoples, you have local communities, all come together in the board and to see how they can achieve all what they get as engagement. And we cannot talk, as I said earlier, about one goal achievement without talking about the second one. So the coordination needs, firstly, among the UN agency, firstly, how the UN food and the UN climate change and UN security and human rights can all come together and discuss about the SDGs, because they cannot do them sectors.
So,
and yes,
Hindu, I'll have to interrupt you because
just the measuring is really very important. We love to talk a lot, but we are not talking about how we can measure this one. And 2013 is just about tomorrow. Then I'm thinking about the life of my people, so we don't need to.
Thank you.
Stop.
I think 2 points. Firstly, the SDGs have been launched and are driven by government at the bureaucratic level. We have yet to drive them through society. And so this awareness, this discussion, help explaining them, I think is absolutely critical in the education. The second part, when we talk about what's going to make the SDGs work, if you use the example of HIV/AIDS, Anglo-American was the first major company to provide medicines to employees and their families. When one does it, the rest follow. Groups like ICM in mining is a group of the top 23 mining companies establishing standards, working together, and then using those standards as guidance for the rest of the industry. That's the intergroup cooperation. How do we then drive that across industries is this dialogue and forums like this, getting the awareness there. People will come. Finally, I've got great faith in the millennials. They will reward good behaviour. And as we promote what good behaviour looks like, the consumers will, I think, in the long term, based on all the market research we've done, they will reward good behaviour. So our people understand what it looks like and how they can play their part, and our behaviours will follow.
Thank you. Helle.
Thank you very much. I know we're in a rush, so I'll say two things. First of all, we shouldn't lose hope. I think we're here today because we really have hope that we can create a better world. And let's remind ourselves that the world is a better place now than it was 20 years ago. I mean, children, for example, have never been healthier or wealthier or better educated than they are right now. And of course, we can have progress in the coming years. The problem is that we don't have a big economic growth to support that. That's what we've had for a number of years. We don't have that. So the only thing we have left, and then I come to the second thing, is that everyone has to be all hands on deck. Everyone has to join this journey, and that's where I think the most important in this conversation is actually partnership, partnership, partnership. Everyone can do something. All organizations, all businesses can do something. And if you find it impossible or difficult to get started yourself, speak to your local NGO or any NGO to get started, because that will bring you to a place where we can create a value chain that is really worthwhile, where we can create deep partnerships, where we can use technology, where we ensure that we have the localization and listening to the people that it actually concerns. That is where partnerships come in, the whole value chain of partnerships. So that is what I think should be the final word that we take with us, partnerships for the Sustainable Development Goals.
Thank you, and thank you for summarizing it for me as well,
Helle.
And with this, please join me in applauding the speakers. Thank you.